You can hear me. I'm not able to hear you very clearly, but I hope you can hear me very clearly because that is more important.
Yeah, I can hear you. And I extend a very warm welcome to you. And I would like to ask Ayush to officially introduce you.
Okay, ma'am. Good morning, everyone. Good morning,
can
ma'am.
Can you hear me, Sami? Because I'm unable to hear you.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, then it's fine. Then it's fine.
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay. Dr. Amina Qazi, ma'am, is professor in the Department of English, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. Her doctorate was on Canadian literature with specific reference to the evolution of literary canon. She has researched and published in the areas of literary translation, post-colonial literature, and resistance writing, with special interest in contemporary works. Her publications include English-Canadian Literary Canon, Emergence and Development Partitions, English translation of Kamleshwar's award-winning Hindi novel, Kitne Pakistan. Her co-edited books include Translation, Representation, India, English Women Poets. Her work in press is Premchand on Life and Literature, English translation of Premchand's select essays. She has subtitled half a dozen documentaries, latest being Moti Bagh, selected for India's documentary entry as 2019 Oscar Awards in USA. She has been nominated by US government for International Visitors Leadership Program in 2007. In addition to teaching and research, she has served as head of department, foreign students advisor in Jamia, honorary director, Jamia Senior Secondary School, coordinator, Access Micro Scholarship Program, funded by United States State Department through its embassy in New Delhi. We welcome you, ma'am.
Ma'am, it would be nice to see you. Everybody wants to see you. Yes, that's better now.
Yes. Thank
you.
I'm also very interested in seeing. I can see Sami.
Yeah.
And I want to say good morning to everyone.
Please say hello.
It's a very chilly morning here in Delhi, and I assume it's the same in Aligarh too.
So
I'm very happy to see another cap wearing colleague.
Sure.
We are so cold. Yeah. So I'm going to say thank you for the introduction and thank you for inviting me to talk to my younger colleagues and friends. And a bigger thank you to the Academic Staff College, as we used to know it earlier, for inviting me to be once again, at least emotionally, in my alma mater, which is Aligarh Muslim University, since I did my master's here very long back. So thank you, Sami, for giving me this opportunity. And I'm going to plunge straight away into what I plan to do this morning, which is a little presentation for my younger colleagues. And hopefully, it will help them evolve their teaching strategies in the classroom situation. So I've called today's presentation Canon, Classic, Critique, the Classroom Practice or Praxis, which is, well, a more jargonized word for the same thing. And I'll welcome all those who are listening to me, though most of you, like the generation today, doesn't want us to see your faces. So you have your little identities there. But anyway, so I'm going to start off with the premise that most social communication, know it today, calls for evaluation. And we are doing it all the time when we communicate. So I'm suggesting that both animal and men engage in communicative processes, which get subjected to evaluation. It is this evaluation that is subject relative and potentially informative. So I'm beginning off with the idea that communication is the guide, which helps us in determining the implications and interpretations that we draw out of, our ways of wanting to communicate with others. All right. So I'm with this premise, and what I plan to do is think with our literary text as an academic tool, which is what we all engage in. And we are familiar with different kinds of texts since the era of literature has broadened out a lot. It is written, it is, and it is also audiovisual. So I'm beginning by saying and stating, and we can discuss it, that in the creative arts, which includes literature, evaluation involves processes of validating the artist and also the artifact. In this case, our artist is the author, and the artifact is usually the written text. And as students of literature, and also as stakeholders in the field of 21st century literary studies, we are engrossed in an academic engagement that pertains to reading strategies, especially those that have a bearing upon the classic. And all of us literature engaged in addressing texts in the classroom, which our curricula says are classic within extent or the other. And I am proposing that our reading strategies and in our classroom strategies, we resort to what I've called are the four C's of literary praxis. So to put it in a formulaic form, these can play be explained as literary studies, evoking, first of all, canonical concerns. That's the first one. Canonical concerns lead us to creating classics from the canon, curricula or curriculum. And this leads to curriculum constructing piece. In other words, this kind of a formula that all of to be a curriculum point of view is a classic.
Excuse me, ma'am. Excuse me, ma'am. Just one minute. Excuse me. Your sound is very low. It's not very clear.
The same thing is happening when you speak.
It's broken, ma'am.
I can hardly hear what you are saying from that side. So that's why I asked, I said, if you can hear me, it's okay, because it's more important. Can you hear me?
You may be coming closer to your mic would help.
Sorry?
You come closer to your mic.
Well, I'm almost sticking my mouth into the mic. I make it even closer. So you won't see me, but you can hear me better, because I think that's more important.
That's better.
It's better.
Okay. So I'm going to stick my mouth into the mic, in which case I don't want to be seen with just a mouth opening and closing. It's better that you hear what I'm saying. So I'm going to continue speaking with the mic thrust into my face. All right. Okay. So what I am trying to emphasize is that we as teachers go through this exercise of having the text and following that pattern of the four C's, which I've mentioned. The first part of what I have to say is to present the four C's as I mentioned them, and then focus on or the postulation involved in these four C's, as I say. We are looking at these four C's. I'm suggesting that the four C's are sequential and cyclical, which implies that in literary studies today, as students of literature, our endeavor begins with the first stage, which is canon, which can perhaps then be described the identification of canon, of literary canon, or texts that fall within the purview of literary canon as a kind of genetics of literature. And this genetics of literature looks at literary heredity to determine the future of the texts that are chosen as a part of our teaching and our classroom activity. When we look at canon, I'm giving a very general overview. We can say that canon has been defined as the criteria that have been most important and influential in shaping culture, especially literature. So when we look at the term canon, this is a very generalized kind of a view. And the makers of literary canon, coming to our specific field from this general definition, people who are a diverse community. It comprises individuals, it comprises institutions, and it also comprises the publishing industry. So, as far as our subject goes, the canonical enterprise seeks to select, it seeks to transmit, and it seeks to perpetuate the text, as well as the methodologies that go into the evaluation of the text. So, we are concerned with selecting the texts at the first level, transmitting them on various levels to our students, and also perpetuating the text as a methodology that goes into the evaluation, our evaluation of the text to our or before our students.
Hello, excuse me, ma'am.
This evaluation, as I call it.
Hello, Rafiq, ma'am.
With literary merit. Yes?
Ma'am, wait, the voice is not stable and clear, ma'am.
We just get some voice,
but it is not audible, and we can't listen you properly. I'm sorry to disturb you, but it's happening.
No, it's okay. Please do disturb me, because the purpose of me giving this long bhashan of mine has to do with you being able to hear what I'm saying.
No, but I think voice is stable.
Now, no, is it better now? Because I can hardly hear what you're saying.
Yes, better, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. It's clear and better, ma'am.
Okay, so then maybe the gods of technology have decided to favor us. So I'm going to hopefully be heard. So can I continue from where I had stopped last time, if it's okay?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, there is an echo. Yes, maybe if you have switched on two audios in two different devices.
Sorry? Cannot hear what you're saying.
Hello, ma'am. There's an echo to your voice.
If two devices are on, the echo would be heard. Please unmute one device.
No, there is no, there's just my phone which is on, and there's no other device which is on.
Okay, ma'am, so I don't know how to help it. Thank you, ma'am.
No, is it better now? Because now your voice is coming as a bad echo.
Everyone's voice is echoing, ma'am. So I think the administrators correct the problem.
But with me, it's perfectly fine. I'm sure that other participants as well, they are fine. It's possibly the network problem with the other participants.
Yeah, because there is a constant echo, which I can hear when you speak to me. And you say that you can hear my echo, my voice echoing when I speak to you.
Because other participants have put their microphone on. So first, we need to correct ourselves.
No, so I would request that everyone who's listening may please mute themselves. Put their microphone off. If you've done that, then I'll continue. Okay. So it says, ma'am, please continue, and I will. So I've got my mouth right next to the mic.
Ma'am, please continue. There is no problem of sound. There might be the problem with some of our colleagues in their networks.
I have a feeling that if you have maybe another phone lying nearby, then there could be an echo. But if you can hear me now, I will continue. And I will continue from where I had stopped last time, where I was mentioning who makes the literary canon as a text that we teach. And I suggested that this is a very diverse community which is responsible for creating the literary canon that you and I deal with in class. This community comprises individuals, academics, that is. It comprises institutions, and it also has the publishing industry playing a very significant role in the entire process of canon formation. So when we look at the canonical enterprise, we can understand it to be an effort that seeks to select, that seeks to transmit, and that seeks to perpetuate texts as well as the methodologies that go into the evaluation and the teaching of that text. This evaluation of the so-called literary merit in a text relies on the basis of analysis, interpretation, of comparison, and contextualization for approval and incorporation into a domain of literary recognition and exclusivity. These are the parameters for including it, in other words, in the curriculum that you and I teach. This exercise of canon formation is fraught with some danger given the subjectivities of the evaluative community and the contentious issue of whose authority or writ runs in the identification of literary texts to be taught, to be read, and to be perpetuated, as they are said to have significant cultural and literary value. So it is a contentious exercise, and I'm not going into reasons why, but we all know that some people feel that text A and author A is very significant. Others say no, author S is far better. So this is always an ongoing process of fixing the canonical text to be taught. But just to give another kind of a generalized opinion, I would suggest that canon is in a state of continuum as it is constructed and reconstructed through evaluative processes that always endeavor to validate authors and texts by looking at the past of the text and the author to formulate the future and the classroom situation of that particular text. This is what I meant by the first stage of the class praxis, which comes across to us as the issue concerning canon, canon being, in a sense, the genetics of literature to determine the future of author and text. So that was the first C, in other words. The second stage in the C cycle is what canon endeavors to identify and sanctify. That means, what are the practices involved in first identifying and then being able to justify the text in terms of literary merit? And to do this, I suggest that canon-making agencies have had to develop relevant parameters and paradigms. And over time, these parameters and paradigms have evolved in a way that literary texts are identified. I'm looking at T.S. Eliot to buttress this argument, which I have just made regarding the second stage. And I quote him when he says, open quotes, "The outstanding quality of a classic is maturity. It can only occur when civilization is mature, when a language and a literature are mature, and it must be the work of a mature mind." So here is Eliot suggesting that a certain level of maturity has to be present in the place, in the text, and in the mind of a writer for a classic to be declared and found relevant to be a part of curriculum. And he goes on to say that the text, and I quote, "needs to have comprehensiveness in relation to its own language and also in relation to a number of foreign languages," unquote. And this is a pointer towards the fact that seminal texts or classic texts that we teach, canonized texts that we teach, are not only significant in their original languages, but they have to be seen as seminal in other languages too. And an example would be the Russian classics that we read, Dostoevsky and Pushkin, etc., where the seminality of the text is seen not only as a part of Russian literature written in Russian, but most of us have enjoyed them in English translation. So Eliot is suggesting this is the second stage, and added to this dimension of the classic or classical by suggesting that these works have enriched the human mind. This is the phrase that St. Beuve uses to say that a classic or a canonized text which needs to be taught should enrich the human mind. And the writer, he says, and I quote, should have spoken to all in his peculiar style, unquote, which should be contemporary with all time. So St. Beuve, in addition to what Eliot says, talks about contemporaneity of all time. And therefore, the second stage or the second C concerns the status of the classic, which has to be bestowed on a text, not only underlining the work's importance and influence on subsequent works, but it leads to the third stage in the C cycle. And the third stage in the C cycle is one where identified classics find convergence in the framing of literature curricula. So it has to do with convergence of curricula. And this particular area involves a framing which invites constant revisioning and compilation. In other words, with time, there is a constant looking back to see how new texts can be incorporated and perhaps some of the older texts can be kept out. So canon and classic join together in this framing of the third stage, which makes it incumbent for the creative and the critical to complement each other, and our literary histories as we study them, being students of literature, bear this out, because literary histories foreground milestones and markers that qualify literary production down the ages. Whether you and I, as teachers involved in selecting texts to teach, they will continue, or you would like to replace them with new texts. As an example, which I have seen in my own life, when I was doing my master's, we had Bernard Shaw being considered a very seminal writer, a very forward-looking dramatist. But in today's curricula, if you see it within our country, Shaw has somehow been forgotten. And I think that there are good reasons that people have for putting him, in a sense, to the margins and replacing Shaw's works with something else. So this was the third stage, where classics either find convergence with other classics and they continue to be taught, or they are replaced by new versions of literature, new productions of literature. This brings us to the fourth stage of the cycle, the C cycle, which is the critique. Very often, students make the mistake, our students, believing that a critique means finding weaknesses, finding flaws within a literary text. But you and I, as teachers of literature, know critiques means evaluation and assessment. And critiquing traces its initial stages to literary criticism. And literary criticism was an attempt to respond to and to rationalize perceptions of any given text that one had in one's hand. So, with academia feeling the impact of globalization in the last century, and then academia involving its principles of interdisciplinarity, we find that the vantage point of the literary critique has shifted from criticism to theorization. So we have seen that critiquing, which earlier was a process of response and evaluation of a literary text, as we might say, perhaps find in the Romantics, or we might find in the New Critics, that has undergone a change of orientation from pure criticism of texts to theorizations that are borrowed from other fields of knowledge. And this has to do with interdisciplinarity that has emerged through the pressures of globalization as we have seen it. So when we look at this change in critiquing from criticism to theorizations, I'm suggesting that this is an approach that seeks to review the literary text through the lens of cultural, political, economic, and gender theorizations borrowed from the social sciences. So literature now, as you and I teach it and read it, reaches out to other areas of knowledge like culture, politics, economics, and gender studies. And the tools of reading in the light of this reaching out or interdisciplinarity have to be re-examined, and therefore new evaluative parameters have to be prescribed. And that is what you and I try to do as the classroom praxis, where we try to link what we are doing as a literary text, not just to its textual and its contextual implications, but we try to link them to other allied interdisciplinary subjects. And as a result, we find that in our field, literary theories have proliferated, with each theory trying to suggest a system and various parameters to rationalize and explain the textual experience that you and I as readers come across in preparing our text and author for classroom exchanges. And this becomes even more important because given the COVID situation where we are not meeting eye to eye and face to face, we are looking at systems and ways in which we try to find links with other subjects. And that is what the new area of digitalization in our literary field concerns. It's a new emerging area where we talk about digitized areas of literary study. So when we look at the fourth stage and we are looking at critique, we are looking at how our classroom practices have to reach out to various other subjects and various other forms of information, especially the digital world. So having looked at these four stages, I'm suggesting that each time the last stage in the cycle is reached, which is the critique, a new cycle is initiated. Why? Because we have to again determine whether carrying over what were earlier the canonized texts to be taught in the class is something which is relevant to our course, or should it be a casting aside of literary texts which perhaps do not meet with our standards of contemporaneity, and therefore there needs to be a new list maybe or new authors and texts to be included in our curriculum. And I end this first part of my talk by underlining the fact that research in literary studies, and by research I don't mean just research as MPhil or PhD, but research in terms of evoking the interest of our graduate, postgraduate students, and then showing the way to researchers. So this is what I mean by the term research when I use it here. And I'm suggesting that research in literary studies today is invariably guided by this quartet of canon, classic, curricula, and critique. The four C's that I began this part of my talk with. So the reason why I chose this particular area of exchange with you is because you and I are teaching texts and authors which are prescribed to us, which we are handed down as our course allocation, which we are expected to do not only as addressing the specifics of the text in terms of implications and meanings, but also in terms of how that particular text might reach out to other texts, might reach out to history in terms of its placement and in terms of its content, and then from history reaching out to other areas. So we are not only now interested in doing so, so to say, the textual meaning and implication. Our studies have broadened into new areas which have to do with reaching out to other subjects. And therefore, our teaching or classroom practice demands that we reach out in terms of information that we make available to our students and to other sources that might be listening to us or interacting with us as teachers. So this had to do with more of theorization in terms of how curriculum is determined, in terms of how our teaching praxis needs to be changed a little bit to what I was traditionally used to as the textual centrality and seminality of interpretation. So this, excuse me, this had to do more with theorization. But in the second half of what I have to say, I am looking at a text and I'm focusing on the canonical assessment and application of that text from a pedagogical point of view. So in other words, it's a kind of practical criticism, if I may call it, to what I set out to do it. Okay. Just to kind of emphasize my point, I am first speaking about what you and I have inherited as a background to the knowledge that guides the way in which we teach our authors and texts. So I would say that our literary legacy grows out of very many decades of intensive indianization, which led to mechanization, which brought about economic prosperity, which on one hand engendered imperialism, it engendered colonialism, it resulted in two world wars, but positively speaking, it also gave rise to freedom movements, it initiated and hastened and catalyzed disintegration of empire. It resulted in various phases and conditions of post-colonialism and neo-colonialisms. And speaking in today's terms, what we know as the age of post-truth, or as Mr. Trump's followers would have us believe, alternative facts within quotes, that is the phase that we have now. So when we look at all these things, some positive, some negative, which have shaped not only the world, but they have shaped the creative imagination of authors in the last 100 years, we can say that we are living at a time where we are familiar with epochs or phases of opposition. So we talk simultaneously of destruction and construction. At the same time, we look at dislocations and relocations. We talk about chauvinism and submission. We are familiar with the discourse of master and subaltern. And we are now being made familiar of fact, as Gandhi would have us believe, or truth, and subjective truth has given rise to. So given the nature of cultural production over the last 100 years has changed, and the paradigms and precepts govern responses, our responses as teachers to this particular brand of literary production has to do with new evaluative standards, parameters, paradigms, and expressions. So we could sum up literary production, which you and I inherit not only through our experience of being students, but also as teachers who reach out to students now. Our experience as student and as teacher is marked by certain features, which I am giving as six. The first one, and I'm not going to go into details because I think we'd all be able to look at our text through these particular features. The first one has to do with life. That's the first I'm suggesting. The second one has to do with literature that usually focuses on the ordinariness of subject, the ordinary, rather than the fantastic or the superhuman or the suprahuman. The third has to do with the coincidence of form and angle of vision, the angle of vision that we have within a literary text. There is a kind of a configuration between form and the angle. In other words, the text and the context. Very often, the literature that we now teach, we try to highlight the apocalyptic undertones, which is another feature. We are all aware, looking at the fifth feature, that literary production has to do with various very interesting kinds of epiphanies that we suddenly find within our text, whatever be the genre, whether it is poetry or drama or fiction or whatever. Then another feature has to do with the diversification of verbal patterns. And these verbal patterns come to us through very specified and interesting implications of image and metaphor. And the last feature, which I think marks the literature of the last a little over 100 years, has to do with literary structure. It is panoramic sometimes because it portrays a canvas of life. It is interpretative at other times because it illuminates human experience. It is prophetic at other times because it evokes intellectual logic as well as imagination. The last point in which I pointed to three specific structures that we can identify in literature. The first one, as I said, was panoramic, the second interpretative, the third prophetic. Just to explain this better, when we look at the panoramic, we are looking at literature, which gives us a very broad opening, a very rich kind of picture of a life, which is of dimensions that are not focused on one individual or one thought or one way of experience, but it covers very many areas. Then the interpretative has to do with human experience. And we do find that some of the most powerful literature that we identify and we teach and we try to convey to our students concerns human experience, which is the interpretative feature. And the third one is prophetic, especially when we look at so-called children's literature, but actually it is, in a sense, imaginative on one simple level, but on a deeper level, it has more to do with the adult world than with the children's world, especially when you look at things like Harry Potter, maybe. So I'm looking at how these features now are ingrained within many of us as areas of address in the classroom. So in other words, when we look at literary production of the last century or so, we see that whatever we are teaching from what is known as modern literature, we find that it has become modern on the basis of current canonical assessment and classification. It has become relevant for us as teachers because it is incorporated into the curriculum and because it is found to be having just the right kind of openness for being critiqued. So when we look at this literary production, we are looking at literary critiquing that has emerged very, very strongly in the 20th century. And I know, personally speaking, that as a student of literature, for us, it was very important and it was academically required for us to be able to refer to critical voices So we had critics like Walter Pater, whom we hardly hear of these days. We had critics, the new critics, Cleanth Brooks, for example, whom we hardly refer to these days. So criticism was the in thing, so to say. But when we look at the latter half of the 20th century and these two decades of the 21st, we find that criticism seems to have receded into the background and it has been replaced by theorizations and theory. And most of us are, in a sense, a little unsure and a little uncomfortable with theory, because very falsely we believe that what is jargonized has to have complexity. And complexity implying that if you can speak jargon, then you are a better voice of literature than someone who speaks in the critical idiom and not in the theory idiom. So this has, you know, slowly evolved. And I know that we are very uncomfortable, most of us, when we have high theory. But just to give you an example of how jargonization has become a very important facet of theory. When I was in MA, we talked about natural imagery. That was the term that we used, all right? And then suddenly when I was teaching and I happened to go to the American Library, I found this new word, which for a minute left me totally zapped, so to say. All right, where natural imagery, the term natural imagery, had been replaced by holozoization, okay? And there was this author who spoke about holozoism as a new term to talk about natural imagery. So you see, it's just like having, you know, old wine in new bottles, so to say, idiomatically speaking. The old idea of natural imagery being given this particular definition or terminology of holozoism. So you see how theory tends to jargonize very often, and that scares us. So getting back to what I'm saying, I'm suggesting that theory takes its cues from the nature and processes of the human mind, where theorists, in terms of what their intellectual side tends to identify and then describe, that has to do with the theory that they come out with. So as a result of theory, what happens? The text comes to be seen as a discourse. We now say we frequently use the term discourse. The earlier term that I as a student was familiar with was the study or the criticism. Now we say it's a discourse. And this discourse of theory is colored by ideologies. Ideologies that are usually social, political, religious, or gendered, because theory shows its inclination towards interdisciplinarity. All right. So we are looking at how theory is usually coming out of other subjects. So we have, for example, Marx, who comes into the picture as a theory or who gives his theory propounding some kind of an economic aspect to life. And then we have others, lots of theorists who talk about linguistic variations and nuances of language. So we have a whole lot of theorists talking about that. So what I'm suggesting is that theory is born out of social, political, religious, or gendered realities. And in the course of examining the creation of meaning, theory resorts to metaphorical decanonization as someone like the Verdis would have us believe. So we are looking at these theories. We are looking when, for example, when you look at deconstruction or postmodernism or poststructuralism or whatever else, we look at how this is a kind of a metaphorical decanonization that comes about because we have to decanonize and then recanonize through theory new identities that the text will throw up. So, having said this, that theory has now come to take a preponderance in our subject, I plan to just examine and talk about a text which has very many links to what we teach in various different other texts. And the seminal text that I'm referring to is Sophocles, going back to ancient Greece. Sophocles' trilogy, or his collection of three sequential plays, which go by the title of the Theban plays. And they comprise three different plays, all interconnected, which are: the first play is King Oedipus. The second one is Oedipus at Colonus. And the third one is Antigone. I'm looking at Sophocles because most of us, or at least my generation did, have Aristotle as a very seminal critical voice, his Poetics. We all had to go through a text like D.H. Lawrence's Sons and Lovers. And as time has evolved, we have seen how recently, well, not very recently, but in the recent past, we have had these kind of narratives becoming a part also of our filmic tradition. So I've taken up the Theban plays, which has for more than 2,500 years been seen to conform to the evolving demands of canon, to the evolving demand of classic, curricula, and critique. The first play, just to give you a quick overview of what this trilogy is about, which, remember, in the eyes of Aristotle, was the ideal playwright and perhaps the ideal play. The first play, King Oedipus, is a story of a man defeated by destiny and unknowingly killing his father, marrying his mother, ascending to the throne, and fathering children from his own mother. The second play, Oedipus at Colonus, is the continued tale of the same man, Oedipus, who is now a shamed individual. He's a blind king turned beggar who's only awaiting for death after being rejected by his sons and wandering around with one of his daughters. The third play, Antigone, is the story of the beggar king's daughter, Antigone, who was ruled by conscience when having to choose between divine decree and human law. So this is a very quick run through of the three plays. And I would suggest that it would be reductive to see the Theban plays as a work simply of imaginative creativity. The impossibility of logic of a man killing his father, marrying his mother, fathering children, then becoming a beggar, and then his daughter choosing to side with divine decree and not human law. But when we look at these, the Theban plays, it is no doubt a work of imaginative creativity, which is born out of ancient Greece drama, which held festivals, or also as a text that underlines human helplessness in the face of destiny dictated by divinity. So when we look at Sophocles' tale, as has been woven into many texts over time, we are familiar, for example, with Lawrence's Sons and Lovers, which I mentioned. We link it to Freud's theory and various other ways, depending on the text that we are looking at. So, to contemporanize the Theban plays would be to view it as a work that is subjectively objective. And I'm using two supposedly disparate words, subjective and objective, together. Subjectively objective would suggest Sophocles as the creator and us as the receivers of the play. On one hand, to explain this term, the Theban plays borrow from established domains outside literature, that is mythology and psychology. On the other hand, it is a very nuanced weave of statecraft and womanhood together. So we can identify four very disparate, diverse things in it: psychology, mythology, statecraft, and womanhood. And so we can see it as a work that has carved out its own canonical space and recognition without adhering to what are known as the intellectual protocols of academic domains. So we are also acknowledging on one hand that Sophocles' plays have inspired Aristotle's poetics, and that is how the creative as Sophocles' construction generates the critique, which is Aristotle's response in terms of talking about drama in his work, The Poetics. So, going by the protocols of criticism in the past, the Theban plays can be considered and examined and evaluated and assessed and taught in a number of ways. On one hand, the plays symbolize the intersection of the extremes, or the mingling of kings and clowns, within quotes. The mingling of kings and clowns was Sir Philip Sidney's definition of Sophocles' drama. How kings and clowns, the upper crust and seemingly the vulnerable and the weak, being brought together. It could be examined as a text for grounding, and I quote Coleridge, confusion and subversion of the natural order of things, unquote. This was Coleridge's viewpoint. Its tragic hero in Antigone was a woman who could be assessed, and I quote Bradley of the 20th century, the site of conflict, therefore a psychologized reading of dramatic persona, unquote. And there are a number of 20th century views, given how criticism comes to have a very strong role to play in literary studies. We are looking at Cleanth Brooks and L.C. Knights in the 20th century, who look at the same trilogy as, and I quote, an artifact that forgets the actuality of the audience, unquote. So here is a little comment that points out to maybe a little flaw in the reception of the plays, where Brooks and Knights talk about the actuality of the audience being forgotten. And then when we look at Raymond Williams's quote, where he says that drama, and I quote, remakes myths with inescapable connections to contemporary experience and social institutions, unquote. We are looking at how he sees contemporaneity and relevance as being inescapable in texts that were written thousands of years back, but which we can see connections with our own experiential world today. So on one hand, new critics like Brooks and L.C. Knight are talking about one aspect of the plays. We have Raymond Williams talking about another. So do you see how the protocols of assessment and criticism differ in terms of responses to the same literary text, or in this case, the trilogy that I'm referring to. So, contemporanizing this particular text naturally dictates new evaluative strategies that help us in revisiting and revisioning the trilogy. And one strategy could be to localize the text along what T.S. Eliot had spoken of. And I quote, that every nation, every race, has its own critical turn of mind, unquote. So Eliot spoke about nation and race as having its own critical parameters of intellectual thought. Implied in his words is the need for spaces and places to evolve a literary poetics rooted in specific localized frameworks. So how localizations have to be seen in what was earlier a text that lay far away from the local. And the most obvious form of localization is the translation of texts, like Sophocles' trilogy, which has sustained its place in the annals of canon and curricula. And good translations not only transform the work into a multicultural text, but translations also invigorate and give new life to the area of translation studies. So we are looking at how a text reaches out from one locale, from one space to another readership through translation. That's one example of contemporanizing a text. Another contemporanizing exercise is the reworking of nomenclatures and literary centricities like first world or third world literary production. So we are talking about how there are certain terminologies that came into being, first world and third world. We are familiar with Oriental, Eastern, or Asian perspectives in contrast to Occidental, Western, or Eurocentric ones. We are familiar with womanism, womanhood sensitivities instead of feminism or gender concerns. These are new terms that have come in, and there are new ways of looking at what was earlier under the broad heading of feminism. In the case of Sophocles' trilogy, we find that the text throws up its own contrastive stances and binaries. They concern the problematics of power in all the three trilogies, and they are represented at different levels. There is the ruler and the ruled, and from our contemporary point of view, the rebel and the conformist, the orthodox and the liberal, the real and the mythological, and the compulsions of statecraft versus the ethics of humanism. And also on another level, masculine authority juxtaposed with female conscience. Now, these are all issues that emerge from the text from today's academic, theoretical, critical postulations. So many things which earlier perhaps were not looked at least not in my time when I was a student of literature way back in the 70s and the 80s. So continuing with this contemporanization of this text, we are also open to postmodernist formulations that the text invites us to engage in. So though the text proceeds along the line of grand narratives, as critics would have us believe, someone like Lyotard would have us believe, we find that the text changes its tack in Antigone, especially the third play of the trilogy, by representing anti-elitism and anti-authoritarianism. So here is Ihab Hassan commenting on these grand narrative of Antigone, saying that it represents anti-elitism, it is anti-elite, and it is anti-authoritarian, according to Ihab Hassan. Then in doing so, establish dramatic convention, that is the centrality of the ruler is subverted, and the drama becomes a symbol of how art looks forward to endorsing a woman's rationale and action. So look at a play which has been written more than a couple of thousand years back, looking forward to how a woman's rationale and action has to be maybe appreciated by the reader or the audience. In its representation of an ancient civilization's cultural and religious myths, because remember, ancient Greek drama was a form of worship, Sophocles' trilogy approximates what Linda Hutcheon, one of the very well-known critics, calls historiographic metafiction, which is another feature of postmodernism that invites the attention of our current literary research. So this, when we look at this text, which is a seemingly united text and at the same time a disunited text, because the so-called protagonists of the first, the second, and the third are different people, and the final play focuses on a woman. The trilogy in its entirety seeks a kind of a deconstruction for final meanings and interpretations, which are deferred as possibilities of opinion. For example, one deferred possibility is who is the real tragic figure in these plays? Another issue that one delves into and finds difficult to answer is, does destiny overrule man, or does man create destiny? Another important issue, which when you read the place, you have to deal with. Then a third issue, who is the good citizen? And these days, the discourse in our contemporary world has to do with issues that concern a good citizen. And Sophocles' play, we are talking about who is a good citizen? The one who obeys without questioning, or the one who questions while obeying? Then another issue, should faith supersede decree, human decree, or should it be the other way around? Which should supersede which, faith or human decree? Besides all these issues, which strike us as very important when we read the text from our current position in the 21st century, we find that this interrogative open-endedness that the work represents is something which is much more than what traditional commentary or criticism perhaps dealt with. And therefore, we find that in the text, there is a character which is actually not a single character, but it is a group of Theban elders as citizens who offer a critique of statecraft as well as authorial intervention. So they voice not only Sophocles' authorial voice, but they are also as voices who together critique and strongly resist the decree of the state given through the ruler. So that's another issue. Then when we read this text from another interesting viewpoint, it is the post-colonial one. And we find that the subaltern perspective also surfaces as one of the dynamics of ruler and ruled, of articulation and silence. So we also find elements of the post-colonial. And it is a very interesting twist of fate in this particular text that the ruler becomes the subaltern by the end of it. And the articulate becomes the voiceless. And the oppressed subdue the oppressor. So there is a kind of a subversion by the time the trilogy comes to an end. So these are very interesting dynamics that one can see as post-colonialisms and neo-colonialisms. So the play throws up new structures of power, and also these new structures naturally are articulated as constructs. So we can see how Sophocles' work embodies variations of authority and power. And we naturally acknowledge that Sophocles is one of the texts which form the basis of drama as you and I teach it in class. So when we look at the Theban plays, we can say that the ways of critiquing these plays, as mentioned a little while ago when I was speaking, underline the fact that they are informed and shaped by the history of ideas. It has to do with our understanding and our perception and our novel of the history of ideas. And this text has achieved very high canonical status because if we go by what Gadamer says, it's because, and I quote, it signifies, interprets, and speaks in such a way that it says something to the present as if it were said specifically to us. And Gadamer continues, in a classic, and I quote, the duration of the power of a work to speak directly and fundamentally is unlimited. So here we have, I have taken Gadamer's quote to talk about what is a text that is canonical, what are the reasons for us choosing texts for being canonical and being part of curricula. And therefore, I'm suggesting that contemporary literary study and research has to be grounded in response to text rather than the creator of the text, where the author is not as seminal as the text in itself and responses to the text. So we have to see, as students of literature, the text as a finished product that has survived the rigors of canonical determination. It has survived the rigors of time and readers and evaluators. And therefore, we are looking at canonical texts that are culturally sensitive, that are politically aware, and ideologically conscious. And these three things are from today's vantage point. This assumption and this relevance of cultural sensitivity, political awareness, and ideological consciousness answers the call of critical pedagogy that examines texts as multifaceted constructs. And this is a very important highlight of what I've presented, that you and I, as students of literature, must be able to convey
to our next generation the multifaceted constructions that we find within what we are teaching. Very often, classics do share the same thematic orientation, but what sets them apart is the subjectivity of representation, how the subjective or the personal becomes different to anyone else's subjective and personal representation on the same thematic orientation. So I end by saying that we as students of literature must hone our tools and our strategies of study and research so as to enrich and enlighten our students. And the best way of doing this is looking both to the past and to the present to formulate our paradigms and precepts for reading and teaching literature. In other words, for reading and teaching literature as our classroom praxis. And with that, I will come to the end of my presentation, but I've also been seeing that there are a number of questions. So what I'm doing is I'm looking at the messages now, and if I can just get back. Will that be okay?
Okay. Please do, ma'am, please.
Yes, so I can only hear very faint voices, and two people have already left. Someone is talking about it's holozoism, as I see one, someone asking for the spelling, holozoism. All right. Then we are looking at, but someone says, but no such word is there in Google. Do you know the trouble, Drishya, is that Dr. Google is our greatest source of information. And I take that with a pinch of salt. So don't look for Google as the most authentic source of information. Sometimes there are things which are subject to question, even uploaded on Google. What is this? Madam, please upload this video. I don't know which video you're talking about. Psychology, mythology, statecraft, and what is the fourth one? Oh my God. So there are people who actually are taking notes. Right? Someone has answered the question, womanhood, women. Okay. Drama remakes myth. Who said this? I think the practical example of it is Sophocles. And drama does not always remake myth. Drama creates myth. And that is known as mythopoeia. Okay. Then what is this? Historiographic. What? Metafiction. All right. The answer has already come. Okay. What is apocalyptic literature? I'm talking, yes, then someone answers. I have to thank everyone who's answered the questions that are asked. Someone says, what is apocalyptic literature? And someone answers, thank you, Priyam, for saying, I'm talking about apocalyptic undertones, that sense of utter destruction and hopelessness that you find in literature or our interpreting literature as having apocalyptic elements. Then someone says, do you suggest that a category such as modern literature is an outcome of pedagogy, pedagogical strategies? I would say yes. From a historical point of view, modern was 20th century because it is looking at time that they've run out of ideas. So modern is 20th. But now we are in postmodern. All right. That's one. That's a historical perspective or vision. But when we look at pedagogy, don't we see modernity in some of the most ancient texts that I've done just now with Sophocles? So do you see contemporaneity is, as you say, an idea or an interpretation that we bestow on a text. It's an interpretation through which we drag a text out from its time to our own time. And that is contemporaneity. All right. Then someone says, on the line of man creates destiny or destiny overruled by man. Oh, he's given us a good example, Natsimrat. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it correctly because it's a Marathi play, he says. Which is a
yes, ma'am. It is Natasamrat, ma'am.
Natasamrat.
Yes. And recently, the play is converted into film also.
Which I have done earlier. Okay. So, holozoism is the term for natural imagery. Okay, but wait, I'm going down the questions. Now people are leaving and I'm getting that. Someone says, but we have authors who have written self-reflexive essays calling their writings modern. Wolf comes to mind. She proclaims, make it new. Remember that every author considers themselves to be modern. So downtime, every author who writes, even 1,000 years from now, will say that they are modern as seen from their own time. Okay. Right. I think that's all the questions. Are there any more?
Good morning, ma'am. This is Priyam. I wanted to ask a question.
Yeah, please. Just be a little louder, Priyam, because you're sounding like ma'am, someone speaking from a bed.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. Yes. I can't hear anything now, Priyam. Priyam, you're not.
Priyam, ma'am, unmute yourself. Priyam, ma'am, you have muted.
Sorry. I hadn't put my mic on. I had put my mic on mute. Ma'am, you have very beautifully summarized the literary legacy, you know, down the decades of how we began with mechanization and you had come down to. You had delineated, you had pointed out various.
Alternative fact, yes.
Yes, ma'am. Could you please repeat that again?
See, I'm trying to suggest that the way human perceptions and definitions have evolved over time, they have become more and more complex. And that's why I kind of gave you the example of this whole business of fact and truth as compared to what is now given to be a totally different kind of take that we have, right? So, this whole thing earlier, the earlier term that we had was post-truth age or time, all right? And post-truth implied that there was nothing like the truth, which is the generalized perception of truth as let us say Gandhi had it, non-violence, for example, or Martin Luther King had it. You know, I have a dream, the truth of the Afro-American experience, for example, or Mandela in his autobiography talking about the truth of being a black man. All right. So there was something known, if I may use the term, as a standardized truth. Okay. But what is happening today, especially given what's happened in the US in recent times after the election, or in fact, during the campaign for the election, we had a new term where there was nothing like the term truth. Fact was given an adjective, alternate facts, which means there was nothing like one fact. Fact could be one for Amina Ghazi Ansari, it could be another for Priyam, and it could be another, let us say, for Professor Sami Rafiq, right? So truth has evolved into a perception which is now replaced by fact. And fact is not one. Science would suggest that facts are solid, unchangeable, fixed. But in discourse, currently, we are being told that there is nothing like fact. My fact is my fact. And that is my eternal fact. And it is not subject to change. And that is why we have a lot of what is today being called resistance writing, because people are challenging. And if you are reading the news these days, this whole set of people talking about alternative facts are led by a man like Trump, President Trump of the US currently, who says that he won the election. But when he went to even the US Supreme Court, the court said, no, you have not given us facts. So we do not believe your assertion that you have won the election. But he says, no, my alternative fact is that I have won. Now, what do you do through this? That means one is acknowledging, or the intellectual world, people would like the intellectual world to acknowledge that there is no one fact. That fact is given to interpretive facts, depending on who is speaking.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. That was such so explicit. Ma'am, I would like to ask...
Please, Priyam, you know, now you seem to have gone deeper into the well.
Well, am I audible now, ma'am?
Sorry?
Am I audible?
Yeah, you'll have to speak louder because outside my home, the Swachh Bharat truck has come to collect garbage and they have this song which they play very loudly, which I'm sure you can also hear, all of you.
So sorry, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yeah, somewhat.
Somewhat. Ma'am, you had outlined 7 points, around 6 to 7 points. What was the first one? Could you please repeat that again? Before ordinary...
The features of literature as we see them today?
Yes, ma'am. New evaluative parameters that govern our ideas today.
Okay, so I had been... I talked about certain features that literary production is marked by.
And
there were 7 of them.
7, yes, ma'am.
Right? The first one was the correspondence between life and literature.
Okay.
The second one was the author's focus on the ordinariness of subject.
Yes, ma'am.
The third one was the coincidence of form and angle of vision, where authors chose a form which they thought was suitable for the literary vision that was to be presented.
Yes, ma'am.
The fourth had to do with apocalyptic undertones.
Yes, ma'am.
The fifth had to do with a variety of epiphanies being presented. Ma'am.
Okay, Professor Meena Kazi, sorry for interruption.
You know how language is enriched with different elements.
Sorry for the interruption. This is Dr. Pedwai, the director UGC HRDC.
Oh, assalamu alaikum, Pedwai
Sam. Waalaikumsalam. And let me welcome you, thank you on behalf of our very competent course coordinator, Professor Sami Rafiq. It is so good to see in every session she is there. She is such a conscientious person. And my dear course participant, you are very fortunate to have a scholar like Professor Amina Kazi. She has been the chairman Department of English at Jamia Millia Islamia in Delhi and professor there. But essentially she is one of us from Aligarh. She did her master's, MA. Her father was very closely associated with Aligarh Muslim University. So her husband has been a student with a very distinguished journalist, Javed Ansari Saab. So we consider Professor Amina Kazi as one of us, isn't it? Although he has his seat in Delhi at Jamia Millia, but his mind and heart is at Aligarh. We hold him very dear, and he's such a generous and kind lady, and of course a scholar. So I'm sure you must have benefited from her presentation, and I wish you the best. So Professor Kazi, thank you very much for your patronage, and we look forward to drawing upon it in future as well. Okay.
Thank you very much, Qidwai Sahab, as I say. And I'm only following in the footsteps of my father. His first job was in Aligarh and then he shifted to the government of India. So thank you very much for your kind words. And it was wonderful to listen to the questions. And you can keep in touch with me if you want. It'll be nice to hear from any one of you.
Yeah.
So thank you and all the best. And may you, all of you, the participants, be lecturing one day like us from the other side of the
worthy colleague, assistant director, Dr. Faiza Fasi. She also joins you in thanking you and wishing the course participant a very rewarding and fruitful session with Professor Amina Kazi. Thank you, Professor Sami Rafi. Thank you. Please resume. Go ahead for whatever few minutes are left. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, director, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Ma'am, in your lecture, you told about Sophocles trilogy, and you said last. Can you hear me?
Oh, can you just be a little louder, please, because I can hardly hear what you're saying. Yes, go on.
In your speech, while discussing about Sophocles' trilogy, you finally came to the conclusion that the subalterns became the ruler. If we discuss things from the post-colonial point of view, then we see that sometimes it's not possible for the subalterns to raise the voices, and their voices remain silent.
Yes.
So is the case with canon also. Canon is based on certain selection criteria, and that happens at the cost of certain other writers who have been excluded from that paradigm.
Yes.
So modern criticism, which has become anti-elitism and anti-authoritarian, has been resulted in breaking that canon in certain extent. My question is, how far contemporary criticism has been able to break canon, for example, English literature? And even if a re-canonization takes place, how can we think that it's neutral and it is free from subjectivity?
Okay, see, I'll answer your question very briefly because I believe that you have another session. My answer is that within our own literary, within our own professional careers, have we not seen the incorporation of new fields of literary study, like Indian writing in English, like South Asian literature, like South American poetry? So we are expanding. It depends on the institution and the individuals who are responsible and who are in the position to be able to incorporate new things. In Jamia, for example, many years back, when I was a young girl, pop music was something which my father detested and he would not allow us to listen to in his presence. But do you know some of the most powerful pop music or popular music songs are those which find resonance today? And I actually included some pop songs in a paper that had to do with 20th century lyrics. So we had, this song Imagine by the Beatles, and we had Blowing in the Wind by, Bob Dylan. The reason for this is that we are expanding and we're trying to incorporate new areas. So that is for the individual and the institution to be able to indulge in. Okay, and then as far as, the other point that you made, that, it's very difficult for a subaltern to become a ruler. If you read Franz Fanon, The Wretched of the Earth, this is what exactly he is saying there. He says, a time will come when freedom struggle will lead to independence. But the ruler of the pre-independent, colonial stage would be replaced by a post-independence native ruler who will turn out to be perhaps worse than the foreign ruler. So read The Wretched of the Earth. You'll get this message. Hello, do I answer your question?
Yes, ma'am, you have answered my question, and thank you.
Ma'am, I have a question. Can I go ahead?
Hello.
I think
is it okay for me to keep answering questions? You don't have another session. I don't mind answering questions.
No, ma'am, I'm not eating this time. This should be the last question.
Just a very short question. Something concerning the question which was put forward by Ms. Triyam a while back. You were talking about the difference between truth and facts. Should that come under, can we broadly classify it under something called post-truth? I'll just give the definition for all the listeners here. Post-truth is basically a word which was inserted into the, which was cited in 2016 as the word of the year in the Oxford English Dictionary. Post-truth is the public burial of objective facts by an avalanche of media appeals to emotion and personal belief. The difference that you were trying to highlight should come under this broad term.
See, post-truth is a term which has evolved out of conditions at a certain point of time in the history of the planet, right? Post-truth has come to have a dimension today which has grown out of political exigencies in the United States.
And so one, let's say, category of post-truth is alternative truth, which is what I spoke about and I gave the example of in the context of the US election. So yes. There are different categories that are now going to emerge in this broad umbrella term post-truth. That's what I foresee.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you.
And I think that it's over now, the session. Thank you, ma'am, for this wonderful lecture. And it's been very, very inspiring. There's been so much to learn in it. And as you can see, the participants have taken such a keen interest and there's been so many questions. Despite the connectivity problem, you can see that it has awakened a lot of interest. Thank you so much.
I do want to thank you, Sami, very, very specially for inspiring me to speak and making sure that I do it on time. And I also want to wish everyone who's been involved in making sure that at least I could be heard and others could be heard very softly by me. So thank you to all those individuals for getting this going through technology. Bahut bahut shukriya aap log. As always,
thank you.
Thank you.
Rajesh ji, I mean, I don't have any session with you.